Well, good morning, everybody. So good to see you in worship this morning. Let's all stand and praise God.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good.
Worship. We haven't done one of these in a while, so follow on the screen with me. How shall we live in the love of God? We will treat one another with fairness and dignity. How shall we witness God's forgiving love? We will reach out to others with compassion. Come, let us worship God who has always loved us. Let us worship God, perfected in lives of hope and peace. Pray with me. Lord, we come this day to worship and thank you for the many ways you guide our lives. We ask that our hearts, our ears, and our spirits may be open to your healing words of love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be.
You pledge yourself to me, and it's why I sing your praise. Will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder weakness, your strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all guilt and rid of all shame, and known by her true name. And it's why I sing your praise. Will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, words and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. And it's why I sing your praise. Will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
Amen. I know that's a tough challenge to praise God, especially during 2020, but he's good, isn't he? He's good, he's faithful, he's merciful. And we praise him today. Amen. Thanks for worshiping. Turn and high five in the spirit, a neighbor. Wave at them. We can't touch. That's right. I know. It is still 2020. Amen. You can take a seat. I told Pastor Clark, you know, I'm going to remember a lot about 2020. Maybe the pandemic. Maybe the toilet paper shortage. But you know what I will remember is that the Hogs won an SEC game. You know what I'm saying? That's right. That's good. So 2020 is starting to look up. It's still looking real good. Texas lost yesterday, so it was a great weekend. It's good. You're in church. It's good to have you. It was just a great weekend. If you got time this morning, if you'd like, we'd encourage you to do that, is to pull out your smartphones and go ahead and fill out your Connect card. It's online. Go to our website, FUMCSS.com, and you can fill out your Connect card. Just say, hey, man, I'm here this morning, and my family's worshiping with me. If you're online this morning, it's so good to have you on several of our streaming platforms. Go ahead and take the time to say, hey, I made it. I woke up. I'm in my PJs with a cup of coffee, and we're glad that you are. But to let us know just that you're worshiping with us, and it gives you an opportunity to maybe share some prayer requests if you'd like. But you can do that on your smartphone, and on most Android devices. So appreciate you doing that. So excited to see y'all this morning. So excited about this week. All of our small groups are back in action. We got connection groups, or actually some Sunday school groups, starting to meet in the evenings in-house, and the fellowship hall socially distant, and on Zoom, and even some conference calls almost every night of the week beginning this week for about an eight-week period. So if you haven't yet connected to a small group, call the office, see Pastor Clark, and we'll get you fixed in. Want you reminded that we are, although the pandemic is continuing to go on, we are still doing our due diligence to make sure that our building is sanitized and clean when you come in and after you go out. Chairs are socially distant, so we are still doing our due diligence to make sure that you come in safe and you're still able to connect with people. So if you're a little bit hesitant, man, I'd encourage you to try it. Just see about coming in and seeing a connection group. That it's beginning to be a real challenge for some of us still to stay connected. So in some way, in some form, we'd encourage you to stay connected, and small groups beginning this week will help us to do that. Next Sunday, our church's charge conference this year is next Sunday on the 7th at 1 o'clock. So we meet with our DS, and we have our charge conference. If you would like to participate in that, you can email Pastor Clark or call him, and he'll send you the Zoom link. So it'll be via Zoom next Sunday afternoon at 1, and just, again, an opportunity to kind of celebrate some things our church has done this year and to get a little business done, and should be a good time. So we encourage you to get upon that Zoom link. Also, another episode of In My Kitchen. It will be coming out this week. So I went to Brooke Coffee's house, and she cooked up an awesome dessert. So that's going to be on YouTube and Facebook coming this week. And also, if you've got a great recipe, I'd encourage you to call me. I asked my wife if it would be good, I could do a coffee recipe for like 30 minutes. She said, I don't think about it. That's going to work. So I thought it was a great idea, but apparently not everyone's into coffee as I am. But if some of you have a great recipe, especially a prime rib recipe, you call me and we'll come. And do you have one, Linda? You have a good prime rib recipe? I think she does. So just call me, we'll come and film it. And it'd be a great time. Let's take some time for joys and concerns. Any this morning in the house that you'd like to share today? Yes, Jim. Okay, all right. Jim Young wants to pray for his friend Bob White, who had a heart attack last night. I want to pray that he recovers. Yes, ma'am, surely. Okay. Shirley wants us to pray for her sister-in-law, who's Thelma, who's having cancer. I want to pray for her. Absolutely. Pray God's mercy, kindness. Yes, ma'am. No, Flo, I'm sorry. I want to pray for Flo's daughter, who was recently diagnosed with cancer. Linda? Glenda. I'm sorry, Glenda. Flo's daughter, Glenda, has cancer. I pray for her. Yes, ma'am. Way in the back. See you, Ann. Absolutely. We want to really pray for our nation. The next 30 days are huge for our country, and pray God guides us. And it's with our leaders. That's right. Anything else? Yes, ma'am. Yes, actually, our president and Melania have COVID, so I want to pray for their recovery. Amen. Anyone else? All right, join. Let's pray for some of these needs. Let's join us in prayer and lift these up to you. Heavenly Father, we're thankful that you are in charge. You are working in and through and among us. We're so thankful that you are faithful. You are good. You are good to us. You are good to our families. You are good to our nation. And we pray, God, that in this, on things that maybe we not understand, knowing that you're good, we pray that you would work in and through them. For Jim's friend Bill, we pray his recovery with his heart attack. God, I pray that you would strengthen him. For our president, God, and his wife, we pray that you'd heal them in a speedy recovery from COVID. For our nation, as we look towards the election, that you would guide and direct us, that there would be peace and civility and a heart for unity among us, that we would be quick to hear and listen before we are quick to speak, and that we would continue to pray for guidance as we come towards our election, for a safe and great election. And we just pray it works out towards the things that you want to bring out in our country. We just lift those up to you. We pray for Glenda. We pray, God, for her diagnosis. We know that you are bigger than a diagnosis and a prognosis. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with Glenda. Pray that she is healed. You would be with her heart and her mind. Give her peace that passes all understanding, and that you would guide and direct her. We lift up our small groups this week and pray that not only are they safe, but they are a great way to people to connect and to be spiritually edified as they meet together. And for those of our parishioners who are at home, we pray that you continue to give them strength, let them know that they're loved and thought for and cared for, and that you would keep them safe as their home. And we're so thankful that they can join with us by your Spirit. In your name we pray, amen. Amen. For our mission moment this morning, the conference has pushed 200,000 reasons for a long time, which is an initiative for food scarcity in the state. Over 200,000 kids in our state aren't sure where their next meals come from, and they've added to that initiative with literacy. And so one of the things that we've done to kind of meet that need is we've added a little library in the Timothy Team area. We have tables set up, and we've added a library, a little table of books is all it is, and encouraging kids to read, and we give them Bible bucks if they read, and we give them more Bible bucks if they read to a neighbor. But we're asking for your help. We're going to ask over the next month of October, probably October, for a little book drive. We need some more books. We have about two little cases of books, and we would love some more. And so we would love for you, if you'd like to buy some books. There's a little cheat sheet in this area, and that's Once Upon a Time books in Tawnytown, really affordable books. They're kind of expensive nowadays for a nice kid's book. But we'd love for you to, and we're asking for you to maybe pick one up. You can drop it off the office. You could drop it off at the mission table on your way in on Sunday morning. If you'd like, you can give towards the 200,000 reasons in your offering or online in some way, and we'll buy some books and encouraging reading. There might be an opportunity for kids to fall behind this past year. We want to encourage them how important it is to read, and that single skill is so important. It sets them on a great trajectory towards the rest of their education, so we want to encourage that. So that's something that we do in Timothy Team, and we'd love for you to be a part of that. You can also, as we continue to worship, you can also give online. You can give in the mail this morning. And so let's pray over our offering. We have a special offertory from Timothy Team. They're going to sing Who You Say I Am. They sang it last Wednesday, and you're going to see the video as we head to the kids' church. And so we're excited about they're singing it. You can't see their little faces because of the mask. They're masked, but they're singing it. We have some hand motions, and so we'll enjoy that for our offertory. And then let's pray. God, we thank you once again for your many, many blessings to us and towards us. We thank you for our redemption and the priceless grace that we have in the gift of your Son, Jesus. We pray this morning as we give that you'd know we're giving with a grateful and cheerful heart. Some of us, we're giving sacrificially. Our bank accounts don't show a lot, but Lord, we're giving knowing that you are faithful and you are good to us. And we pray, Lord, that you would receive these tithes and offerings and just as a way of us knowing we trust you, we have faith in you, and we're excited about the ministry that you're doing here in Siloam. And all these things we ask your many blessings. Amen.
Always free. see that I did not turn my mic on. Okay. So thank you, Timothy team, for that wonderful addition and sharing that piece of worship with us as we go about our worship this morning. So this morning I want to bring a word from you to you from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 18. So if you've got your Bibles with you, I want to encourage you to open them up to Matthew chapter 18, and we're going to be looking at verses 15 through 20. If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two or you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. It's the word of God for the people of God. So, I've been watching this fabulous new show on Netflix lately called Away. If you haven't checked it out, I encourage you. It's about this show centers around the first manned mission to Mars. And so, it's not so much a sci-fi show. So, if you're not really into sci-fi, it's, well, I don't know that I would like that because I don't like sci-fi things. Okay. It's got science fiction part to it, but it's really more about how people interact with one another. I mean, imagine for a moment you are you're with five individuals and you're traveling millions of miles across space in a tin can. You have very little place to go, okay? You've got to learn to get along, right? And what about the people back on Earth? And the loved ones that you have left behind. And so much of this show is really about the interrelationship of these five astronauts on their way to Mars. They're going to be with each other in close quarters for 3 years. Imagine that, 3 years with the same people day in and day out. We've only been in this pandemic 6 months, okay? All right, so 3 years, they're relying on each other. And so with such a situation like this, you kind of got this implied community compact, okay? There's no place for dishonesty. There's no place for selfishness. And so they need each other. They need for each individual to recognize that the community and harmony within the community is paramount, not only to their success in the mission, but really, literally, to their own survival, okay? And so there's this scene in this show, in a way, there's this guy named Popoff. So just so you know, a little bit of context, this is a group of astronauts from five different countries. You have an American, you have a Russian, you have a Chinese, you have someone from India, someone from the UK, but they grew up in Ghana. And so you've got all these different cultures represented here, all these different countries. And so there's this character, Popoff, and he's begin to display symptoms of a deterioration of his eyesight, a phenomenon called space blindness. And this is an actual thing. So I was like, I didn't realize this was a real thing. But there are actual astronauts who've experienced a deterioration of their eyesight while in space. Thankfully, a lot of that recovers by the time when they get back to Earth. But sometimes there's some lasting effects. But nonetheless, he begins to experience the deterioration of his eyesight. And that would pose a problem when one of five of you begins to not be able to see very well. It becomes especially difficult when you happen to be the engineer, okay? So this is the engineer, and so part of his ability has been to do his job has been compromised, and it could have life-threatening consequences. Now, one of the characters in the show goes to him in private and says, "Hey, I can see you're having trouble here. Your eyesight is deteriorating. We need to do something about this." He denies it. He's like, "No, I'm fine. So then that character goes and gets another person, and they go and they confront him again in private. And again he denies it. So finally the entire crew comes together, they confront him, and the truth comes out. And eventually this transgression is forgiven and he's been reconciled to the group. Now, why all this talk about this TV show? Well, as I was watching this show recently, and as I was kind of studying this passage, I began to see there's a lot of similarities in this group dynamic. You know, when you have this implied social contract of living together in a community, and a lot of it's similar to what Jesus is talking about in today's passage, what he's teaching us about how we resolve conflict in the church. Now, Jesus keeps it pretty simple. In fact, he kind of gives us a first century conflict resolution 101, okay? And if you, as you read there, it's really just a three-step process. We're told in verse 15 that if a member has sinned against you, that you're to go to them in private and try to resolve the issue. And if that doesn't work, then you're told in verse 16, okay, bring another person or two and go to that person again in private and resolve the issue that way. And if that still doesn't, they're still unrepentant, then in verse 17, we're told as a matter of last resort, bring it to the community of faith for resolution. Now, why do you suppose that Jesus employs this three-step process? Well, the first thing we have to remember is that Jesus is operating out of an honor-shame culture. See, in the ancient Near Eastern, you didn't just go to somebody out in public and call them out on something. You could shame them, and that would create probably a bigger problem than the sin that they committed against you. That really the best thing to do was to go to them in private and try to resolve it before escalating the situation. And the second reason is that Jesus is also operating out of a Jewish context. And Jewish law, the Mosaic law, had a lot to say about how to handle conflict and how to if charges are being brought against somebody and accuse somebody, how you deal with it. And so we see in here echoes of Deuteronomy 19:15, and we'll put the scripture passage on here. And so what Deuteronomy 19:15 tells us is a single witness shall not suffice to convict a person of a crime or wrongdoing in connection with any offense that may be committed. Only on the evidence of two or three witnesses shall a charge be sustained. Now, I will tell you that we have good reason to believe that this principle was still in play at the time of Jesus. And one of the reasons is a little bit later in Matthew's gospel, as well as the other gospels, we have Jesus being brought to the Sanhedrin on the night before his death. And that the religious leaders are actively looking for ample witnesses to speak to Jesus' blasphemy and rebellion. That they need that in order to convict him. And so we know then that this idea of you have to bring witnesses with you, you have to have ample witnesses in order to convict somebody or to be able to hold somebody responsible. And so if that doesn't resolve itself, if you first you've tried the one-on-one approach, then you've tried the 2 or 3 to 1 approach, and none of that has worked, then as a last resort, indeed a final plea, if the offender's not repentant, you bring it to the larger community of faith. And if that community of faith, if they still fail to repent, if they still fail to change their ways, then at that point, ostracism from the community is appropriate. And so, as we begin to read in there, where it talks about binding and loosing, something being bound on earth as it is in heaven and loosed on earth as it is in heaven, that begins to make more sense, because now we have the sense that if you follow these steps, these conflict resolution steps, and you're unsuccessful about bringing somebody to resolution and bringing this matter to resolution and restoring that individual to the status of brother or sister in Christ, then you have divine support at that point to say, we're moving on without you. And so this seems a little difficult at times for us to understand in our modern context, because it back then, you know, to excommunicate somebody, to ostracize them, had lasting and real consequences. But we as a society, as a Western culture, we operate more these days out of a fallen kind of John Locke's philosophy of individualism. You know, that philosopher, that Western philosopher, the Enlightenment area, which tells us that you know, we see ourselves more as individuals, and we see the church and the local community of faith as more of a voluntary association of autonomous individuals. And that's especially, we see that here in America. You know, where our country is built on this idea of individualism with emphasis on independence and self-reliance and individual authority, and all of these things are highly esteemed. And so we seem to see, when we read this passage, we're like, well, why would it matter if someone, if they're unrepentant and you said, sorry, you're out? Why would that really matter that much? Or we don't really excommunicate people these days. But if we follow the logic that Jesus uses here, and when he demonstrates to us that it's important to bring about this reconciliation, and instead of following Locke, we begin to look more at what the Apostle Paul says on this matter, and that the church is a body. And that we are parts of that body. Individuals, we are still part of a body, and that one part of the body cannot say to another part of the body, I have no need of you. If we begin to look at that, we see that contrast with Locke, and we realize that the church is at its foundation a place of mutual interdependence. We come together not just to worship here on Sunday, but to have mutual interdependence of one another. That we as a body are incomplete if one part of the body goes away or is cut off from us. And so that's why this conflict between members not only affects the individuals, it can infect and affect the entire community. When we have disunity in the body of Christ, it doesn't only cause issues for the local church, but it has lasting consequences for us as well. So the question then is, how do we fight like a Christian? And what I mean by that is, you know, one of the difficulties we find in applying this concept is that we're dealing with the first century context, which is quite vastly different than what we deal with today. You know, this idea of this close-knit community of faith and mutual reliance. I mean, honestly, I mean, we come together, we worship together. Many of us are worshiping online right now, okay? And we have options. We can walk out the door, or we can turn off the feed and be done with it. But when you consider that in the first century, these tight-knit communities of faith, they were built were less self-centered, you would find that what they did and how they had real life and death consequences. You didn't just cut somebody off from your community. Because if you're dealing with, if you're under constant threat and constant oppression, like first century church was, when a knock on the door could really literally be the beginning of the end for you. That to say to someone, you're no longer a part of us, had life and death consequences. Much like the Atlas crew going on to Mars. They had to get along. They had to figure out how to resolve conflict. And even here in America, if we think about the church, really until about 50 years ago, when the church was still a focal, prominent part of the social fabric of society, you know, to be excommunicated, to be tossed out of your community of faith had real and lasting consequences. But today, the 21st century church is characterized by its individualism, and we don't really excommunicate people. We see our church participation as voluntary, and you know, in a town like ours, when you have 50 or more choices, if you don't like something, you say, well, fine, I'm out of here. I'll take myself and my money, and I'll go somewhere else. Or if you're the offended party, maybe you're the person who was hurt by the actions of another person. What tends to happen is either they make a big fuss as they're out the door, or oftentimes they simply leave quietly. And the problem is never really addressed. And it continues to fester like a cancer. Because the problem isn't gone, just the person who was offended is. So let me ask you, how often have we wished when an offended party, when we offended someone with our actions, that we wish they had just come to us directly to resolve the issue instead of maybe employing passive-aggressive tactics, or worse, escalating the problem through gossip or outright calling us out in public? How often have we wished that we just kind of took care of it politely and in private and just dealt with it? And so what Jesus is suggesting here is that Christians, we have to fight better. I mean, most of us know how painful church conflict can be. Some have left over the church out of a sense of betrayal and protest. In fact, some people leave because they say, you know, I'm used to having conflict in my family. I'm used to having conflict with my friends in my workplace or in my school. But we can't have it in church. We're Christians. We ought to do better than that. We're not supposed to have conflict. But here's the reality. Jesus, even in this passage, seems to assume, hey, you're not always going to get along. You're going to have conflict in the church. You're going to have conflict. He knew he was going to have conflict among his followers. But what makes us Christian is not whether or not we fight, not whether or not we disagree, not whether or not we wound one another, but how we go about addressing and resolving the issue. And Jesus begins by instructing his followers that we need to attempt to reconcile with the offending party one-on-one. We first honor that person. We speak truth in love to that person. We pour our whole selves into the process for the sake of our relationship with the community as a whole. And only if we've exhausted ourselves are we unable to break through to that person, are we to bring the conflict to others in the church, and then even more as the community, as we make available a communal resource of discernment and guidance. See, the church is not fundamentally an institution or a denomination, but it's meant to be a place where two or three or more are gathered to live together in mutual interdependence under the lordship of Christ. And so that means that we have to cast off the yoke of individualism, which oftentimes results in alienation, loneliness, anxiety, distrust, and to a profound trust of commitment with people sometimes different from us. And that means that there's going to be conflict, but it's precisely through the conflict that we model for the world how we bind and loose one another appropriately. It's not a guaranteed solution that every conflict will be resolved successfully. But at the end of the day, if we follow these things, then we know that we've done everything that God has called us to do to resolve the matter. And we've done it in an appropriate way. And we witness to the world Christ's ministry of reconciliation, which overcomes all divisions through the power of the cross. Now, what happens when we not only as a community of faith employ this, but we begin to fight better? Well, first, I'm going to admit that this type of conflict resolution is not fair. It's not. In other words, it's not fair to the offended party. If you're the offended party, you're taking on the burden of resolving the conflict by means that run counter to our predilection of passive-aggressive niceties or outright calling someone out in public. That may be what we want to do, but that's not what we should do. And so it's not fair to us as the offended party. We have to do better. One time I was serving in a church, and something that I had done upset one of the members. And so instead of approaching me personally in private, the member decided to discuss the matter. They began to share their displeasure with others, which began to cause some dissent. And I could have chosen to escalate the situation by engaging in similar behavior. But rather, I went against the polite Southern culture of niceties, and I approached them directly in private. And let me tell you, when I did, they initially were embarrassed because I don't think they really expected me, nor did they really want me to directly confront them. But we talked about it, and we realized where the conflict was, and we, in the end, we resolved it in a healthy way. And I will tell you that once the matter was resolved, we moved into a much better relationship. The point is I could have handled that any number of ways. And let me tell you, I was tempted to handle it in a much more drastic way, okay? But Jesus called me and he calls us to fight better. You know, the Atlas crew on their way to Mars has no choice but to quickly and civilly resolve conflict and bring about restoration. And likewise, the early church, following the model of Jesus, needed to as well. Both situations had life and death consequences. We, on the other hand, have a choice. We can choose to fight like we likely have in the past through passive-aggressive tactics or gossip or simply walking away bitter. Or we can recapture this simple process that Jesus lays out for us, and in doing so, grow as a community of faith. How we choose to fight within the church and outside the church can be an example for both Christians and non-Christians alike. And yes, it's not fair, but it's the hard work that Jesus calls us to. Will you pray with me? Oh, gracious and loving God, Lord, you give us a very simple process by which to resolve conflict in our midst. Lord, let us be courageous enough to employ these. Let us set aside our individual desires and our individual needs, and even if we're the offended party, the desire to somehow resolve it in passive aggressive or bitter ways. Lord, help us to see that we can fight better, we can resolve situations better if we simply follow what you have shown us and what you have taught us today. Help us as we strive to be better followers of you. And this, Lord, we pray. Amen. For those who are worshiping us with online, we are going to close out our worship at this time. For those who are gathered with us together, we will have a time of communion here momentarily. Let's be standing as we sing.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward